Hi, good evening, everybody. I'm Annie Daphne, an application engineer for Martin Lights, and I'm based out of Bangalore. So today I have along with me Ms. Shilpi, Mr. Edwin, Mr. Vinith, and Mr. Sudhakar, who are the panelists. And you can drop in your questions while the session is going on at the QA section that you can see to your right. And the panelists will be happy to answer your questions. And we will also take up some questions at the end of the session. So in our earlier webinars that happened in the previous weeks, we went through all the product ranges and its variants from the architectural segment in Martin. And so today we thought we'll just dive in a little deeper and explore the lighting techniques that you can apply for facade lighting and how we can use Martin's exterior solution ranges on any sample project that we've chosen for today. But before we get into that, let me just quickly, brush up on the products as well to just refresh our memories. So in the traditional wash lighting segment, we have the exterior washes, exterior linears, and the in-grounds. So in exterior washes, we have three series, 100, 200, and 300, based on their size and wattage. So the 100 is a compact 50-watt wash fixture. And the 200 is a mid-range 185 watt fixture, and the 300 exterior wash 300 is a powerful 280 watt wash fixture, and they come in either RGBW quad chip or the dynamic white variant. And also we have different beam angles using externally mounted diffuser kits. In the exterior linear variant, we have two categories, the cove variant and the graze. So the cove can be used for indirect lighting applications like cove lighting for facades. And the graze variant can be used for grazing the surface. Any surface could be a wall or the facade of the building. And we have these exterior linear variants come in two lengths, 1 foot and 4 foot version. And they again have RGBW quad chip and the dynamic white, which is a tunable white variant. And in the in-grounds are nothing but recessed wash fixtures, which can be recessed into the ground. And they're also discrete during the daytime. So they combine the benefits of the wash as well as discrete installation. And the in-grounds come in three series, the 400, 410, and 420, depending on whether they are RGBW, quad chip, or the tunable white variant. So the next product in the portfolio is the image projection, which is the exterior projection 500 and 1000, which is a unique one-of-a-kind product in the Martin portfolio. And these fixtures are... make a building much more interesting using gobo projections and animation effects. And Martin is almost alone in the market when it comes to this product category. And the third last variant is the creative LED product ranges, which are for media facades to play low resolution videos and abstract patterns on the building facade. And in this variant, we have the Pix lines, the exterior dot HP, and the flexible string based VC dots. So these creative LEDs need not only be played as a media facade product using the P3 controller, but can also be run on DMX and RDM protocol for simple color changing and abstract patterns. Okay. And so this is the moving on. This is a sample project that we have taken for today's topic of lighting techniques and concepts. So the reason I've chosen this is because it has a good proportion of solid facade and windows, and also has a lot of architectural elements like the pillars, dome, and detailings on the wall. So this project was specifically made for this webinar. So the 3D model was built using the Dialux Evo 8.0. And yeah, so before we move on to the lighting techniques, I would like to just mention about Richard Kelly, who is known as the father of lighting design. So he was a very renowned architectural lighting designer and started his career early in the 1930s. And he was also known as a very futuristic lighting designer because he started designing lighting for glass facades even that early. So some of his notable projects are the Glass House and the Seagram Building in New York. You can have a look at it after the webinar. And he coined three tenets of philosophies of lighting design, which are very useful for the architectural lighting perspective. So today I will be taking you all through the lighting techniques based on these three principles, and they are ambient luminescence, focal glow, and play of brilliance. So in ambient luminescence is nothing but uniformly washing a facade, and it's also called wash lighting or flood lighting. So in this particular technique, we will be producing a shadowless illumination on the surface and creating a very uniform lighting distribution on the wall. And it's very ideal for solid facades, which has a good amount of concrete because they can reflect off light. And it could be any kind of building like an office or a statue, bridges, churches, temples, monuments, museums, etc. And they are the simplest form of lighting and use minimum number of fixtures. From the Martin portfolio, our exterior washes with a wider beam, which could be flow mounted or pole mounted can be used, or even in grounds with a wider beam can be used for this particular kind of technique. So this is the lighting simulation of our sample project in which the flood lighting or the wash lighting technique has been applied. So as you can see, it creates a nice shadowless illumination on the surface, and all of the architectural detailing is also visible in this kind of technique. So here what I've used is I have pole mounted the exterior wash 300 at different levels for each floor on a pole for the wall to the left and to the right. So if you notice, I haven't placed the pole in the center of the wall because I didn't want the pole to obstruct the clear view of the building. So I've placed them to the side and I'm directing the light at an angle. For the pillars, I've floor mounted the exterior wash 300 very wide beam, and I've washed them to give a nice uniform illumination. In addition to this, I've also added two numbers of exterior wash 300 to highlight this wall behind. So the reason I'm doing it is because if I didn't have this light, then this pillar would create a very bad shadow on this wall, which is not desirable. And secondly, I wanted to create a nice backlighting effect for the pillars. And for the dome, I've created a nice soft lighting using the exterior wash 200, which is mounted across or around the dome on the terrace. And for this portion, which is above the pillar, I've mounted the exterior wash 200s on the ledge because otherwise floor mounting them is not possible. And again, I cannot have a pole right in the center of the building. So in this technique, as you can see, it's the simplest form of lighting, and it creates a nice uniform wash, uses very minimum number of fixtures. But one disadvantage of this kind of lighting is the glare. So in this specific project, again, because of the presence of these windows, the light is getting reflected off and hitting your eyes. And also secondly, because I've mounted them on the poles, you can see the direct source of light from the windows. And also if you're standing from the windows and looking out, you can see the direct source of light. So one way to avoid this is using glare shields. So glare shields come with the exterior washes and they can be externally mounted on the fixture. And another product is a snoot that you can externally mount on the washes, which will reduce glare from different angles. So apart from these two possibilities, another option to reduce glare is to floor mount the fixtures. So instead of mounting them on a pole, I can floor mount them. But this particular project, it would pose a problem, you know, mounting the fixtures on the on the floor. And the reason for it, I'll explain in the coming slides. But before that, let's have a look at the uniform lux distribution that I can get using this flood lighting technique. So as you can see here, just six numbers of exterior wash is creating a nice uniform illumination on the wall, and I'm getting a lux level of close to 100, which is very good for facade lighting. Because when it comes to architectural lighting, there are no set rules which define what should be the lux level for a particular surface or a facade. Unlike interior lighting, where the NBC states the different lux levels required for different rooms. So here we have only guidelines. So one major factor which is defining what should be the lux level when it comes to facade lighting is the ambient lighting conditions. So if I have a building where there is a lot of street lighting surrounding and light from other buildings which will contribute to the light on this building, then I need to have a much higher lux level for this building to stand out. So here we would recommend a lux level of 100 or more. Whereas in isolated buildings or high-rise buildings where the the facade lighting is mostly happening at the top, then there won't be much of street light or a light from other buildings which are contributing to the lux level. So in these conditions, even a low lux level like 20 to 50 would be enough to make the building stand out. So here I'm getting a nice uniform lux level of 100. And since I'm using the wash technique or the flood lighting technique, I need to make sure that the lux distribution is also uniform. So in this example, I've maintained an offset of 5 meter from the wall. And so I've used a very wide beam. So at instances where I need to move the fixtures further away from the wall, then I need to reduce the beam angle. Because otherwise what would happen is if I were to use a very wide beam at this offset of 15 meters, then since the beam of light is always in the shape of a cone, it's going to diverge as we go away from the fixture. So there will be a spillage of light away from the boundary of the building. And secondly, the lux level that I'm getting is also will be very less. So naturally, I need to reduce the beam angle to confine the beam within the building, within the boundary of the building, and also get a good lux level. So this is the same example, but with an offset of 15 meters, and you can see that the light distribution is also uniform and it's quite the same intensity as the previous offset. So this is the example where I had floor mounted the fixtures, but as you can see, because of the presence of these ledges at every floor, I'm getting a shadow on the wall, which is not desirable. So that's the reason I had mounted the exterior washers on a pole instead of floor mounting them. So the prerequisite to have uniform wash on the surface while floor mounting the fixtures is to have smooth wall like this without any protrusions. So in this example, you see I've removed all the ledges on every floor and thus I'm having a nice uniform wall. And the wash lighting effect is also quite good when I'm floor mounting them. So here what I've done is I've placed two rows of washes. The first row I'm using exterior wash 200, very wide beam, to wash the lower portion of the wall. And in the second row, I've maintained an offset of 1 meter and I've used exterior wash 200 medium beams. And I've slightly tilted the angle because these lights are to direct the light onto the top portion of the wall. Because the very wide beam will not be able to reach the top portion, I've used the medium beam to just direct this light onto the second and third floors. So this is the offset that I've made. So the first row, I've maintained an offset of 4 meters. And for the second row, I've maintained an offset of 5 meters. And I'm reducing the beam angle for the second row because, the wider beam angles will not have the ability to reach the top. They will disperse midway. So you can see the uniform lux level that I'm getting. And I'm getting close to 100 to 200, which is very good for facade lighting. Yeah. So in the previous example where I had floor mounted the fixture, there was some amount of glare still present in the ground floor because of the windows in the ground floor. So one way to completely eliminate the glare is to move the fixtures very close to the wall and direct the light upwards. So like in this example, I've maintained an offset of only 1 feet from the wall. And I've used exterior wash 200 medium beam. So the reason I've used a medium beam is because I wanted the light to reach the top. So naturally, because the beam is narrower, I have to increase the number of fixtures. So I've used 20 numbers of fixtures for this stretch of wall. And the offset is only 1 foot. So my glare angle is also less. You will not be able to see the direct glare from the fixture unless you look down from the window. So here again, you can see the kind of nice gradient that you get. So naturally, because I'm placing the fixtures very close to the building, I will have a much brighter output closer to the fixture, and it will reduce or naturally, fade away as we go away from the building. But again, at the top, I'm still getting 600 lux, which is pretty good. So the trick or the technique to having a uniform lighting distribution on a surface is to have overlapping beams. So in this example, you can see that the second beam is actually overlapped to 50% of the first beam. So thus, I'll get a nice uniform illumination on the surface. Because otherwise, if you're having discrete beams like this, you will end up having scallops on the wall, where you'll have a couple of hot spots and shadows, which is not desirable. And these scallops will create a very non-uniform illumination on the wall. So in this example, what I've done is I've increased the beam angle from medium to wide. So naturally, I can reduce the number of fixtures. So from 20, I've reduced them to 15 number of fixtures, and I'm getting uniform illumination. But as you can see, the light beam is not able to reach because now the beam has widened, so which means there will be more dispersion of light. So it's pretty evident in the lux level distribution also, where at a place where I was getting 600 lux using the medium beam, I'm only getting about 125 over here in this image using the wide beam. In this third example, I further increase the beam angle to very wide beam, which is 60 degrees. So now I can use only half of the fixtures. So from 20 using a medium beam, I've reduced the number of fixtures to 10 numbers, but though I'm getting a nice uniform distribution, the light is again not able to reach the height. So now my lux level to the top of the building has further reduced to from 125 to 50. So flow mounting the fixtures is very or is the only option for applications like this, lighting up a statue or a bridge, where it is impossible to have a pole to this height and have fixtures at different levels. So here the only option is to hit them from bottom. So in this example, this is the Garuda, which is in Indonesia, and it's a 122 meter tall statue. And the entire installation is done using Martin. So we have 10 meter poles on which we have mounted all the exterior wash 300s, and we are directing the light upwards onto the statue. And for the lower portions, we have used exterior wash 300 medium beams. And for the top portions where the medium beam would not be able to reach, for example, the face and the top portion of the wings, we have used exterior wash 300 narrow beam, because only the narrow beam will be able to reach that height and also give a good illumination, just like the bottom portion. This is a real-time image of the same Garuda statue. The previous one was a Dialux simulation. And this is a very familiar project, I'm sure. It's the Burj Al Arab in Dubai. It's a 7-star hotel. And there is a bridge that's connecting the show to the hotel, and it's a 300 meter long bridge. And if you notice very closely, you can see that all the exterior wash 300s are actually mounted on the bridge. So there are planter boxes along the bridge, and the exterior washes are actually located or placed inside these planter boxes. And the shooting distance of the fixture to the top of this building is close to 900 foot. So just to give you an idea of how powerful these fixtures can be. And since the requirement of the client was to get a good color saturation and good a uniformity in the color, we used the 300 variant because the exterior wash 300 has a pre-mixed color. And we've used 74 pieces of exterior wash 300, and we have used two different beam angles. So for the lower portion of the hotel, we have used 56 numbers of exterior wash 310, 13 degrees. And for the top portion near the helipad, where the shooting height was 900 foot, we have used 18 numbers of exterior wash 300, 11 degree beam, because only the 11 degree beam would be able to reach that height. So you can see the kind of placement here, which is along the planter boxes in the ground. So this again is a very good example of flood lighting or wash lighting technique, where you can see the kind of uniform lighting distribution on the wall. So the next principle of lighting design, according to Richard Kelly, was focal glow technique, where here we are not creating a uniform lighting distribution on the surface. Instead, we are having areas or specific regions of light and shadow. So how we do this is we choose architectural elements that we want to highlight, and we light up only those regions, thus attracting the viewer's attention onto those architectural elements. So here we are rhythmically dividing up the facade. So these architectural elements could be anything from vertical to horizontal fins on a facade, or windows, pillars, columns, or arches, carvings, etc. And again, this kind of technique is very useful for facades which have a lot of architectural details that we want to individually highlight. And from the Martens portfolio, washes and in-grounds with narrower beams can be used. So they can specifically highlight only that portion of the facade. And also linear fixtures, the linear exterior grazes can be used for vertical and horizontal fins, or carvings, or jali walls, window ledges, etc. So this is our sample project that we have simulated using the focal lighting technique. So as you can see here, we haven't uniformly just washed the surface with light. Instead, we have individually picked out each of these pillars. So thus creating a, more kind of a punch factor, I would say. And again, all of these window ledges are individually picked out. So what happens is naturally the viewer's attention is drawn to these elements. And another advantage of this technique is you will have more possibilities of color combinations. So unlike the previous wash lighting technique, where you can do only two or more color, one or two color combinations at a time, here you can individually change the color of each of these pillars or each of these window ledges again. So what I have used here is for all the pillars, I have used the exterior in-ground 400 with a narrow diffuser, 10.5 degree beam. And for the window ledges, I've used the exterior linear graze 4-foot version, two numbers for every ledge. And even for the portions in between the ledges, I have used exterior linear graze 4-foot version. And for the dome, I've still maintained a soft wash lighting using the exterior wash 200 very wide beam. For the exterior washes and the in-grounds, we need to have a individual pass socket for every fixture. The advantage of the exterior linear is that you can connect them end-to-end in a chain. One chain can have only one 3-pin pass socket. So to have this ability, we have these input and extension cables from Martin, which are hybrid cables, which can carry both data as well as power. So you don't need to individually have two cables, one for data and one for power. So this is the input cable, and one end of the input cable is a loose-ended cable for power input, which is any 3-pin socket, and the other is a data input, which can either be a 3-pin or a 5-pin data DMX connector from the lighting console or the splitter. Now the other end needs to be connected to the chain of fixtures. So these fixtures can be connected end to end, or they can be connected using extension cables, which again come in four different lengths, 0.2, 1 meter, 5 meter, or 10 meter. Now, the maximum permitted total length of fixtures in a chain is 30.5 meters. So you can connect a maximum of 30.5 meter length of fixtures in any one chain. So for example, if you're using the exterior linear 4-foot version, you can have a maximum of 25 numbers in one chain. Now the total length, permitted length, including the input cables and the extension cables, can go up to 100 meters. So this total length is the length including the fixtures as well as the cables, not only the cables. So for our project, the second floor contained a total number of 26 exterior linear 4-foot versions. So which means it's one number more than the permitted limit of 25. So we have divided them into two zones, or two chains, I would say. So each chain has 13 numbers of exterior linear 4-foot version, with five numbers of 1 meter extension cables in between. So because I don't need a fixture to the linear graze to highlight these pillars, so I've used an extension cable in between. And similarly, the right portion also has 13 numbers of exterior linear 4-foot version with 1 meter extension cables. Now the ground and the first floor I've combined together for the left and right. So the left portion has 16 numbers of exterior linear 4-foot with 6 numbers of 1 meter extension cables that you can see in green color. And to connect the ground floor to the first floor, I've used 1 number of 5 meter extension cables. So the total length comes to 30.5, which is well within the limit of 100 meters. And the same thing applies for the right hand side as well. Okay. So this is another variant where I've used cyan and a deeper shade of blue for the focal lighting technique. And in this image, if you notice, I'm not sure whether you noticed these pillars in the previous image, but there are some pillars which are adjacent to these ledges. And now with exterior wash 100, I have highlighted them individually. So basically, I've added another layer of focal lighting here. And that is kind of the beauty of focal lighting, I would say, because immediately, as soon as you see the image, that first thing that comes to your, the first thing you notice are these pillars. So this again is the same project that we have simulated using the tunable white variants. So I've used a combination of 2700, 5000 and 3000 Kelvin light fixtures to create this effect. And this is a lux level distribution. Now, since we are using grazers, obviously the lux level is going to be gradient. So it's going to start out bright closer to the fixture, and the intensity will fade out or reduce as we go away. But still closer to the fixture, you're getting a good 200 lux. This is a different variant where I've just changed the angle of the of how the grazers are hitting the building. So in this solid portions, I've just placed the linear grazers on top. So we have this top-down kind of lighting effect. Okay. So the division of the chains would still be the same. Only thing is that now the length of the extension cable would slightly increase because now I have to connect from the top to this bottom here, like I'm just moving the cursor here. And so the length of the chain 1, including the fixtures as well as the cables, would be 41 meters. Similarly for chain number 2. And for chain number 3, we'll have a total length of fixtures and cables would be 54.5, which is still within the limit. So in this variant, I've just removed the grazers for the solid portion and I've only highlighted the ledges and the pillars. So again, the possibilities are endless. We just need to apply our creativity depending on what is the client's requirement. Okay. So this is a very good example of a real-time example of focal lighting technique. And this is the Auckland Museum in New Zealand, which has been completely done using Martin fixtures. And as you can see here, all of these pillars are individually highlighted. Similarly, we have used in-grounds for these portions within the window ledges. And we've created a nice crown lighting using exterior grazes. So this is the same building, but with the colorful color combination that they have applied. This building, I would say, is a combination of both, because if you see here, the lower portion, we are creating these narrow streaks of light, which is similar to a focal lighting technique. But as the beam kind of bends because of the structure or the shape of this building, I'm getting a nice uniform wash lighting effect on top. So I would say it's a very cleverly applied technique. And this is the Mercedes Superdome in New Orleans, Louisiana, where it's been completely done using Martin's exterior washes. So this is another example of focal lighting technique where we've individually highlighted all of these glass panels. Now you're able to see the light because the glass is not clear glass, but diffused light, diffused glass, which is kind of reflecting off some light. Okay, so this is another technique of focal lighting where we have picked out each of these vertical fins using exterior linear graze 1-foot version. And this is one of my favorite projects, I would say, because the first thing that you notice as soon as you see this building is you will think that it has a nice focal lighting technique, maybe using exterior dot HPs, but no. What the architect did was he created two walls with some gap in between, and the outer wall as w is what you can see. And the architect basically created a number of different sized holes on the outer facade, and the inner wall is actually opaque solid. So the lighting designer placed the fixtures in between both the walls, and she basically washed the inner wall. So what you see outside is nothing but the reflected light through the holes. So this is actually an energy tower in Denmark, which has been done using exterior wash 300. So here again is a good example of a combination of both focal as well as wash lighting, because now the pillars are highlighted using the focal lighting technique, where each of the pillars are individually picked out. Similarly, the steeple, the top portion of the steeple, also has a kind of focal lighting technique, but the wall here and the lower portion of the steeple and the dome has a more kind of a general or flood lighting technique, where it's uniformly washed. So the last tenet of lighting design is a play of brilliant layer. So this layer is basically an add-on layer, and from the Martens portfolio, we can use the exterior projections, 500 or 1000, to have interesting gobo projections and animation effects on a building. And usually, these projection fixtures are used on top of a layer of wash. So, like in the simulation here, there is a general wash lighting on the building, and on top of that, to make it more interesting, we add the gobo projections. So here what we've done is we've used two numbers of exterior projection 1000 to wash the walls, pillar, as well as a part of the dome. So we've maintained them at an offset of 30 meters, and we've placed them at an angle to the side of the building, and we are hitting them at an oblique angle. And I've used the 44 degree beam angle for the exterior projection 1000, but the projection 1000 also comes with continuous zoom. So depending on the location and the distance from the wall, you can choose the zoom angle. This is the same example with a different color combination. So this is a real-time example using exterior projection 1000 at a shooting distance of 110 meters from the building, and you can see the kind of crisp gobo projections that they can create. And similarly, in this example also, we have done a general wash lighting in blue color and amber color, like you can see in the image, and on top of that, we have added the gobo projections. So, any example of gobo projection, we would highly recommend doing a demo first, because when it comes to gobo projections, we need to decide on the angle and the location of the fixture first of all. And after that, we need to do image projection or image mapping onto the building. So the simplest technique would be to go with a custom gobo design. And firstly, we need to have a prototype stencil like this, which is made up of a number of grids, concentric circles with dots and numbers marked. So we put this stencil into the fixture, and like you can see in the image to the left, we will study how the light falls on the building. So, since each of these grids and circles are actually marked, the manufacturers who do the stencil design, they will study this, and they will basically do the gobo projections as per the grids and the concentric circles. So, by doing this, you can actually limit your gobo projection specifically only to your building without having any spillage onto other buildings. And the angle or the size of the gobo will also be very precise. So you can see the image onto your right that the pattern is very, very confined to the building, and it follows or it takes the shape of the building itself. And this precise angling and dimensions you can get using this following the grid pattern for studying how the light falls on the building from this particular angle. So the first step would be to set the location of the fixture and its shooting distance, and then do the grid type technique to actually do the image projection or mapping. So here, if you notice very closely, even the trees have been picked out individually, so that the stencil design is that precise. So this is actually the it's a real-time image, of the Menzies in Switzerland, where they used the exterior projection 500 for their launch day or open day. Sorry. So this is the Flower Conservatory in California, where again we have used Gobo projection. So we use 10 numbers of exterior projection 500 on this, and all the Gobo stencils or the images that you can see are images of real flowers that are in the flower conservatory. And so we took images or photographs of the flowers and then we converted them into stencils. So here again there is a wash layer on top of that. We are adding the Gobo projections. And in this particular example, what we did was we 3D scanned the entire building to create a 3D model out of it. And then we took photographs of the flowers and the other butterflies or whatever, and then we converted them into stencils depending upon the shape of the building. So if you see the stencil here, it's a little bit distorted. It's not a straight or clear image. It's slightly slanted because in this stencil it's looking like that, but when you pull it into the fixture, it nicely takes the shape of the building. So there are very renowned stencil gobo manufacturers that we can approach for any custom-made gobo designs. So this again is a very interesting project where just one number of exterior projection 1000 was used to lit up this entire building, and that too from across the river, which is 233 meter wide. And this is the actual gobo projection of this particular project. And here we haven't used to custom gobo project gobo stencil. We have used one that's available with the fixture. And here they also used a custom for logo projection onto their building. So nowadays a lot of buildings are completely fully glazed buildings, which don't have a lot of solid concrete. And so for glass buildings, the Martin's portfolio products that can be used for glass facade lighting would be contour lighting or perimeter lighting using PIX lines, VC dots, or exterior dot HPs. So when I say contour lighting, it basically means lighting which will mark the boundary of the building or create a nice crown of jewel lighting. And the second technique would be indirect wash. So here, instead of placing the light on the facade, we'll be placing the fixtures like washes, linear grazers, or PIX lines inside the building to wash the solid surface. So you will see the reflected light from within. So it'll create a nice glow from within factor. So this is again a sample project that we've taken, which is fully glazed, and it has aluminium panels just around the gla each glass panel. So in order to have this first technique, which is an indirect wash, you could do two possibilities. The first option would be wash the inside opposite wall using maybe exterior washes or PIX lines or even linear grazers, and you can see from outside the reflected light through the glass panel. So this is very ideal when the glass panel is clear glass panel, because anything that you put on a clear glass would not reflect off anything. It'll just pass through it. So we instead of lighting up the clear glass, which is of no use, we would be lighting up the surface inside to create a nice reflected light. And the second option would be to place the fixtures very close to the glass panel. And to do this, the glass should not be clear glass, but should be a very translucent, diffused material. So in this case, the light will somehow, disperse off the glass and you can see it. Like in this example here, I have used a diffused glass material. So what's happening is, though I'm placing the PIX lines very close inside the building, I can see the light off of it. So this is the kind of the fixture placement that I've done, very close to the glass panel. But if it was clear glass, I wouldn't have been able to see any light. But because the glass material itself was diffused, I'm seeing some nice soft lighting. So in case this glass was clear glass, then what I should have done is I should have washed this opposite wall instead of the glass here. So then from outside, I could have seen the reflected light from inside. So this again is a real-time example of the glow from within factor, where the glass is clear glass. So by placing the fixtures behind the glass panels, I can see the soft lighting. So here again, we have used exterior linear grazers quad version behind each of these triangles. So these triangles are not glass, but they are inflatable translucent material, fabric material, which is inflated using air. And within each of these triangles, we've placed exterior linear graze quad version. So here we have used VC strips behind each of the glass panels to create this nice glow from within factor. Okay, so in at examples, like I said, when the glass is clear glass and you cannot do anything on the glass, it'll be nice if we can wash the opposite wall inside, which is solid. So you'll see the reflected light of it. And this one show writing here is using an exterior projection. And the last technique is the contour lighting, where I've used here in this example, I've used exterior PIX line 40s just all along the building boundary for every floor. And since these creative LEDs are direct view, which means you can place them facing the viewers, they will be able to witness a nice color changes. So you see the light directly, you don't see any reflected light. So in order to use the PIX lines in the DMX or RDM protocol, we don't need the P3 controller. We can use a simple driver, which can be off Martin's or any external driver. So this hybrid cable from Martin will combine the DMX as well as the driver's power input and then drive the BBD cables, which will in turn drive the PIX lines. So the PIX lines can either be connected end to end, or they can be connected using extension cables, which come in 1 meter, 2.5, 5 meter, 10 meter, 25 meter lengths. Okay, so for the PIX lines, the maximum total length in a chain is varies depending on whether they are PIX line 10, 20, or 40. So the PIX line 10 has you can connect only 7 meters equivalent of fixtures in one length, and including cables, you can connect maximum 50. Now for this example, since I used exterior PIX line 40, I can connect a maximum of 25 meters of fixtures in one length, which equals to 21 number of fixtures in one chain. So here, because there are 40 number of fixtures in one floor on one side of the facade, I have divided them into two chains for each floor. Now for the bottom floors, I placed the driver, which is the Martin's PSU, in this manner here. Like you can see, the red yellow box is the driver. And for the first and the second floors, I placed them in the terrace and running a BBD cable from there. So this is a real-time example of a contour lighting that you can do with these creative LED products on a glass facade. And these contour lighting need not be horizontal all the time. They can also be vertical strips like this example here. So here for this one entire vertical line, I've taken considered them as one chain, and I've placed the Martin PSU in the terrace. So again, you could do boxes like this, or horizontal streaks, or you could do alternating vertical strips like this, or just simply outline the border of the glass facade in this manner. So the possibilities again are limitless. You just need to study the client's requirement and do the design as per that. But I'm just giving you different examples. So this again is the visitor center in Abu Dhabi, where PIX lines have been used to do contour lighting for the visitor center. So the visitor center is completely glazed, and so we've created these diamond shaped patterns using PIX lines on the glass facade. So another technique is, if you notice, all the aluminium panels are white color, so they'll be able to reflect off light. So one possibility that you could do is you could use exterior washes, very narrow or no diffuser beam, which is 7.5 degrees. Place them at the bottom and top to create this nice contour lighting effect. And again, it's much more economical, because in this example, I'm using only a maximum of 20 fixtures for one side of the facade and still getting a nice contour lighting effect. Now, because the glass glass in between is clear glass, it will not reflect off anything, and only the panels will reflect off light. This is a real-time example of the technique that I just explained, where exterior washes are placed on the terrace to highlight these vertical fins. And similarly, in every floor, they've placed exterior grazers to create this kind of contour lighting effect for the vertical fins. So then the last technique for glass lighting, especially for high-rise buildings, would be perimeter lighting. And from the Martens portfolio, we could use the exterior dot HP. So perimeter lighting, I mean creating a nice crown of jewel lighting on top of the building, like in the image you can see here. And since these exterior dots are circular in shape and they can have, you can adjust the distance between the dots and they will nicely blend in with the architecture. This is again another example of perimeter lighting, where we've marked the boundary of the building using exterior dot HPs on the terrace. This building is in Indonesia. So in this example, we've created crown lighting using washes, and we've done contour lighting for every floor using PIX lines. So with this, I come to the end of the lighting techniques and concepts for facade lighting. And I guess we can move on to the QA session now. Shilpi, are you available?
Thanks for a wonderful session. As such, there are no questions in the QA section.
Okay.
Only Vignesh, like somewhere in between, he wrote explain, but he was not he didn't specify. But
Okay.
it was a really very nice session. So like I don't think like people will be having any questions until unless they start working on the projects. So this
Right.
was more of like the practical sessions, like how to use the lighting fixtures and how to do the facade lighting and architectural lighting thing. So,
Correct. And also, yeah, it's a repeat session, so I'm sure most of the doubts have already been cleared in the previous the same session that we did last week.
yes, exactly. So, yeah, Devdas Kadam is asking, is there any Hindi session for this available?
We could
So,
do. I'm not sure. Mr. Sudhakar has to, decide
yeah,
on that.
we have planned to do that. You will get the intimation from Harman Pro India, intimation mail. So we will be conducting the same session in Hindi. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess that's it. Thank you, people, for taking time off your schedules to be a part of this session. And stay safe and happy weekend to all. Thank you.
Yeah, Annie, there's one
Yeah.
question from Kiran Mavaria. Yeah,
Okay.
it's like, can we continuous change the light in PIX line?
Sorry, I didn't get you. Can we?
Continuous change the light in PIX line. I guess
I guess he means color changing.
color changing or the intensity changing or the patterns, right?
Yeah, we could do both. So when we are actually using the PIX lines in the DMX protocol, we can do simple color changing and even pattern changing. So in this protocol, we have four modes to choose from. So we have the RGB mode, wherein each fixture is considered as one entire fixture, and you can change the color to either red, blue, or green. And in the basic mode, you can also change them to red, blue, green, and white. And in the segmented mode, you can create pre-programmed effects or macros like rainbow effect, police siren effect. I'm just naming a few, but there are much more, many other effects. And in the last pixel mode, in the pixel mode, each of the LEDs is considered as you can individually control the color of each LED in the PIX line. So obviously, it consumes more number of DMX channels when compared to the previous fixtures. So if you look at the user manual or the spec sheet of the PIX lines, you will get an idea of the number of pixels they consume depending upon what mode you choose. And in this way, you can change the colors and similarly the intensity as well. I hope that answers this question.
Was good reply. Next question is from Adish Chowta. He wants to ask how to avoid light loss or spill light if it's diverging from the intended projection.
Yeah, so the way to do this is to have custom gobo projections. Like I explained, I'll just go to that slide to just make it easier for him to understand. Yeah, so if you look at the stencil here, in order to, you know, avoid light loss to onto adjacent buildings or just into air, basically the stencil is designed so that the beam or the projection is confined only onto that building. So how we do that is we follow this grid method, where this is a prototype stencil which is used by the stencil manufacturers to study how the light falls on the building. So depending on what are the grids which are falling within the building, they design the projections or the gobo patterns only within those grids. So all the other grids which are not falling on the building is made opaque or black color so that there's no light loss outside of this boundary of the building. Is that clear?
Yes. And we also have that zoom option of adjusting
yeah,
the beams.
Right. Now, so for the exterior projection 1000, if you're not using custom gobo projections and you want to go with the, you know, the gobos that are already present that comes with the fixture, we can use the zoom option where you can confine the beam or the projection within the boundary of the building.
So next question is from Govind Swami. Okay. He's asking how to do lighting program. Do we have any software?
Lighting program, Martin was doing consoles so previously, but now we have the Onyx software, which is compatible with any lighting console, which can be from any of the renowned manufacturers across globe. Edwin, do you have anything to add on to this? Edwin or Vinit?
Yeah, yes. Honey, actually, Onyx software works only with Obsidian control system. So we have other manufacturers like MA, Grand MA, and Avalite, and Chances for the console boards. And for the visualizer software, we have Vectorworks, Capture, and even MSD, that is My Show Designer. So that is a visualizer software.
Yeah, so while designing the solution, we can always recommend you those things. So next question is from Shailendra Pratap. Maybe Sudhagar, you can answer. Will get any participation certificate for this training session?
Yes, if they would have enrolled through our professional university, within couple of days, they will get their certification. If they have directly joined the WebEx, then it's not possible.
Okay, thank you, Sudhagar. So another question is from Mr. Pandu. I guess it is for projection. Won't it affect to human eyes? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so what we can do is we do have glare shields that come along with the projections, where it's in the form of a snoot in order to you know, avoid the glare from different angles. But since we're talking about a projection, we cannot, you know, completely put a glare shield to avoid directly viewing the fixture. But there is a, if you look at the user manual, there is a minimum distance from the fixture that you need to maintain, beyond which it does not cause any damage to the eyes. So for the exterior projection, for any, if you're viewing the distance from less than I guess 2 meters, then it would, you know, cause damage to the eyes. But away or beyond 2 meters from the fixture, you will be protected from damaging your iris. And of course, your eyes' natural instincts would come into play and you would either close or move away from the fixture. And similarly, even for each of the fixtures in the user manual, we have a minimum viewing distance that we need to maintain in order to prevent any damage to the iris or the cones and the rods in the eyes.
Yes, that's right. So next question is from Dhiraj. What are the number of inbuilt gobos in the gobo projector?
So we have 6 plus 1. So six gobos are actually they come, these stencils are pre-designed and they come with the fixture, and one is open for custom gobo. So you could use any gobo of your choice, and each of these other six gobos are also removable, so you can interchange them. So they all come in a gobo wheel.
Yeah, so seven gobos we have in exterior projection 1000, but in 500 we have just six, right?
Yeah. So in each of these, we still have one open to do custom gobo projection.
Right. So I guess we have answered all the questions here.
Okay.
Yeah. So for any
Any more
other
questions, you could
questions?
always, yeah, you could always
Yes.
write to us for any project-related inquiries. I'll just go to the slide with all our numbers. So Shilpi is our technical sales lead and also techno-commercial lead, I could say. So you could always reach out to her for any inquiries. And Vinith, Edwin, and myself are from the application team, and we would be happy to help you for any projects.
Yeah, so at the end there is one more question added. That
Okay,
is like,
okay.
do we have a light which can fully highlight the dome?
See, actually, it's basic physics, because light travels in a straight line, and the dome is, of course, kind of a semicircle shape. So it would be, if you're just mounting them at one level, it would be impossible, I would say, to reach the top of the dome. But one possibility we could do that is maybe move the fixtures further away from the dome so that the divergent beam is able to reach where the outer periphery of the entire beam may touch the top portion of the dome. Or another option would be to hide them, to light them at two levels, maybe one row of lights for the top portion and one row of lights for the down portion. But again, we need to see the mounting possibilities in this application.
Yes. So, and next question from Kapil. How can we make custom gobos?
So there are gobo manuf I mean sorry stencil manufacturers across globe, as well as there are a few renowned stencil manufacturers in India as well. So you could always write to us, and we could recommend you the name of the manufacturers who do the custom gobo designs. Shilpi, you would like to add on to this?
No, that's perfectly fine.
Okay.
We have few in Mumbai, like the major one is in Mumbai. So whenever we are working on any project, we can definitely recommend.
Thank you, everyone. Good day.